Hi, good evening. Last class, we have seen some locus in complex numbers. I told you, if you take a line joining two given points, A and B are two points, or two points in the organ diagram, P is a point which is moving in such a way that distance PA is equal to distance PB. Point P is moving, P moves to P dash in such a way, P dash A is equal to P dash B. P moves to P double dash in such a way, P double dash B is equal to P double dash A. Joining all the points, you get a locus. This locus is nothing but a straight line. That straight line is nothing but a perpendicular bisector of the line joining two given points. Now, in complex number, in the organ diagram, if alpha is a complex number, beta is a complex number. Alpha is a complex number, beta is a complex number in the organ diagram. Z is any point which is moving in such a way, this distance is equal to this distance. That means, modulus of Z minus alpha is nothing but distance between Z and alpha. Complex number Z, a variable complex number and a fixed complex number. That is equal to Z and beta, distance between Z and beta. So if mod Z minus alpha is equal to mod Z minus beta, then the locus of Z is nothing but a straight line, This ultimately gives us a straight line. So we come to a conclusion, whenever you find mod Z minus alpha is equal to mod Z minus beta, these two are equal, then automatically Z traces a straight line. Similarly, if C is a fixed point in the organ diagram, Z is a moving point in the organ diagram in such a way that distance is a constant. R. This point moves to some other point, point P moves to P dash in such a way, again the distance is R. P moves to P double dash in such a way, again the distance is R. So joining all these points, we get a circle. Locus is a circle. In the organ diagram, we give this as modulus of Z minus alpha is equal to R. Where R is the distance between a variable complex number. Suppose alpha is a fixed complex number, Z is a variable complex number. This distance is modulus Z minus alpha, that is equal to R. Then the path traced by Z is nothing but a circle. This we have seen. Now coming to the next locus, mod Z plus 2i. Plus mod Z minus 2i, is equal to 6. So mod Z plus 2i, plus mod Z minus 2i is equal to 6. What is the locus of Z? It is different from the previous two loci. That is, loci is a plural form of a locus. Now, we are showing that locus is nothing but this ellipse, circle, these ellipses are hyperbola. So out of these four answers, which is correct? This locus is an ellipse or circle or hyperbola. That's the question. We are in ellipse, we are having two answers. This is one ellipse, this is also an ellipse. Which ellipse is correct? Or if ellipse is not correct, circle is correct, which this is correct or that is correct. And this is correct, then locus is a hyperbola. If this is correct, locus is a circle. Here definitely it is not a circle, because circle locus will be like this. Modulus of Z minus alpha is equal to R. R is a constant. Alpha is a fixed complex number. Z is a variable complex number. So therefore, this locus is different from this locus. This is the form mod Z plus alpha plus mod Z minus alpha is equal to 6. Then automatically, we are showing that this represents an ellipse. Already I told you, we can take how ellipse is traced out. A is a fixed point, say alpha. B is a fixed point, B is a fixed point, say beta. Z is a moving point in such a way, z is a moving point P in such a way PA plus PB, PA plus PB is a constant. PA plus PB is a constant. PA plus PB is a constant, say K is a constant K. Then the locus of P, the locus of P is nothing but an ellipse. The locus of P is nothing but an ellipse. So P is a complex number which is moving in such a way PA plus PB. So here sum PA plus PB is equal to K. Then the locus of P is an ellipse. And the equation of ellipse will be of the form x square by a square plus y square by b square is equal to 1. This is a locus in Cartesian form. This is a locus in Cartesian form. We want locus in Argand diagram. We want locus in Argand diagram. So that locus is this. Mod z plus alpha. This alpha is a complex number. This is 2i. And z minus alpha, beta is nothing but z minus alpha, z plus beta, that is 2i. This is minus 2i, this is plus 2i. And mod z plus 2i, mod z minus 2i is equal to 6. Then automatically, this is the form z plus alpha plus z minus beta is equal to 2a. Then this represents an ellipse. But you want to show this ellipse or this ellipse. So for that, we are having the next slide that gives the answer. Now see here. 2i is nothing but in the Argand diagram, 2i is nothing but 0 plus 2i. It's a complex number, 0 plus 2i, that is 2i. Real part is 0, imaginary part is 2, that is 0, 2 is here. So this point is A, this point is A. 0 minus 2i, that is 0 minus 2i, represents 0 minus 2. It represents this complex number B. A point P is moving in such a way, PA plus PB is equal to 2A. That constant is 2A here. That constant is 2A is nothing but 6 here. So therefore automatically we come to a conclusion that this distance is equal to 2A. 2AE in fact, because this is AE, this is AE. E is the eccentricity of an ellipse. So AE plus AE, you get 2 times AE. So 2 times AE is equal to 4. 2 times AE is equal to 4 because this distance, this is 2, this is 2. 2 times AE is equal to 4. AE is equal to 2. This is one observation we make out from the given condition. So AE is equal to 2. A is equal to 3 because, A is equal to 3 because this is 2A. 6 is 2A. So when 2A is equal to 6, automatically A is equal to 3. So therefore, I am substituting for A is equal to 3. You get 3 is equal to 2. E is equal to 2 by 3. Eccentricity for this ellipse is 2 by 3. We all know for an ellipse, eccentricity is less than 1. For a hyperbola, eccentricity is greater than 1. For a parabola, it is equal to 1. Now, we know the relation between A, B and E. So this is A. This is our A, this is our B. So A and B are connected by the relation B square is equal to A square into 1 minus E square. Substituting for E, we get E is 2 by 3, we get 4 by 9. B square is equal to 5, B is equal to root 5. So therefore, we are getting the equation of ellipse in the standard form. I told you equation of ellipse in the standard form is X square by A square plus Y square by B square is equal to 1. So therefore automatically in the place of A square I am substituting A square. A is nothing but A is equal to 3 already. A is 3 is here. A is 3. B is root 5. So 3 square you get X square by B square. Y square by A square is equal to Y square by B square is equal to 1. Here A square is 9 because major axis, minor axis, minor axis and major axis. That's why you interchange these two. So therefore, x square by b square, y square by a square is equal to 1 because major axis, this is our major axis and this is our minor axis. So therefore, since it is reversed, we are interchanging these two also. So x square by 5 plus y square by 9 is equal to 1. I repeat again, if this number is greater than this number, we get an ellipse like this. If it is other way, x square by 9 plus y square by 5 is equal to 1, we get an ellipse like this. This is y axis, this is x axis, we get an ellipse like this. If this is greater than this, if it's the other way, we get an ellipse like this. So since we are getting an ellipse like this, so automatically we say the correct equation the correct equation of the ellipse in this problem is x square by 5 plus y square by 9 is equal to 1. So therefore, we are discussing locus easily with the help of this problem. Let us take one more problem. It's a difficult problem. We'll understand this. First of all, I'll tell you all the concepts behind it. After that, we can solve this problem. It's a problem, IIT problem. We have asked this problem many times, so it's very important. If not this type, problems of this type will be asked in some other fashion. Now, we are having a fourth degree expression. We are having a fourth degree expression. X power 4 minus x cubed plus x square minus x plus 1 is identically equal to. Two factors are here, two factors are here involving trigonometry. Here two factors are here, none of the above. So virtually we are having three answers. Fourth answer we cannot verify. If this is not correct, this is not correct, this is not correct, this may be correct. So in that case, let us start analyzing A. Let us start analyzing A. Can this be the answer for this? By multiplying these two, do you get this? That's our question. We can simply say it is not, because x square minus 2x plus 1 can be factorized as x minus 1 whole square. X minus 1 whole square, we get automatically roots are 1, 1. We get roots are 1, 1. Here, for this expression, x power 4 minus x cubed plus x square minus x plus 1. For this expression, the coefficients are 1 minus 1, 1 minus 1, 1. Sum of the coefficients is not 0. So sum of the coefficients, these two gets cancelled, these two gets cancelled, we get 1. Sum is not 0. Sum is not 0. Therefore, we come to a conclusion, 1 is not a root, or x minus 1 is not a factor. X minus 1 is not a factor. So therefore, with that, we come to a conclusion, this is not the correct answer. Because this gives x minus 1 two factors, repeated factor. X minus 1 is not a factor. If x minus 1 is a factor, then 1 must be a root. If 1 must be a root, then automatically sum of the coefficients must be 0, which is not there. So therefore, we come to a conclusion, this is not the answer. This is not the answer. Let us try with a second one. Second may be correct, third may be correct. If second one is correct, we say this is the correct answer. We have to verify this product exactly gives us x power 4 minus x cubed plus x square minus x plus 1. We are not getting that. How to say second one is correct answer? For that, what we do is you find the product. You find the product. By finding the product. So first one is not, but because 1 and minus 1 are not the roots. 1 and minus 1 are not the roots. Therefore, A is deleted. A is deleted. Coming to the second answer, x square minus 2x cos pi by 5 plus 1. X square minus 2x cos 3 pi by 5 plus 1. We'll find the product. We'll find the exact product. X square, x power 4. X square 2x cos pi by 5 minus 2x cubed cos pi by 5. X square into 1, x square. Multiply by 2x cos 3 pi by 5 with x square. We get 2x cubed minus 2x cubed cos 3 pi by 5. 2x, 2x, we get 4x square cos pi by 5 cos 3 pi by 5. Minus 2x cos 3 pi by 5. Multiplying with 1, you get this difference. This is exactly equal to the given expression. If it is so, you collect all the coefficients. Question x power 4 coincides. Coefficient of x cubed minus 2x cubed can be taken out. You are getting cos pi by 5 plus cos 3 pi by 5. Cos pi by 5 plus cos 3 by 5. Whereas, if you group x terms, if you group this term and this term, minus 2x cos pi by 5 cos 3 pi by 5. Minus 2x taken out, same cos pi by 5 plus cos 3 pi by 5. It is enough, you simplify cos pi by 5 plus cos 3 pi by 5 and say you get some sum. And simplifying, you get exactly minus x. Simplifying this, you must get minus x cube. So x power 4 terms coincide, 1 coincides. So only thing is, we have to verify x square coefficient. We have to verify a coefficient of x and coefficient of x cube. So for that, what we do is, we are taking 4x square cos pi by 5 cos 3 pi by 5. 4x square, we are taking this term. 4x square cos pi by 5 cos 3 pi by 5. Let us simplify this. What is that you are getting? (Clears throat) 2x square is taken out. We are retaining 2 so that you can apply the formula 2 cos A cos B. 2x square is taken out, 2 is retained, 2 cos pi by 5 cos 3 pi by 5. 2 cos A cos B is cos A plus B plus cos A minus B. Cos of minus theta is cos theta. Therefore, even though you get cos minus 2 by 5, you get cos 2 pi by 5. Cos 4 pi by 5 plus cos 2 pi by 5. This 4 pi by 5 can be written as pi minus pi by 5. This simplifies to 4 pi by 5. So cos pi minus theta is minus cos theta, that is minus cos pi by 5. Cos 2 pi by 5 is retained as it is. We know pi by 5 is nothing but pi by 5. Pi is 180 degrees by 5. So 5, 3, 50, you get 36 degrees. So pi by 5 is nothing but 36 degrees. Automatically 2 pi by 5 is 72 degrees. So therefore, this is cos 72. 2 pi by 5 is nothing but 72 degrees. So therefore, this is cos 72 degrees, this is minus cos 36 degrees. We know cos 72 is same as sin 18. Cos 72 is nothing but sin 18. 18 can be written as 90 minus 72. So therefore, cos 72 is same as sin 18. So substituting this cos 72 is sin 18. Minus cos 36, I am writing here. We know the value of sin 18 and cos 36. Sin 18 is root 5 minus 1 by 4. Cos 36 is root 5 plus 1 by 4. So I am substituting for sin 18 and cos 36. Sin 18 and cos 36. So simplify this, you get ultimately minus x square. Therefore, the term 4x square cos pi by 5 cos 3 pi by 5 simplifies to automatically minus x square. Similarly, we are grouping the terms containing x. Minus 2x times cos pi by 5 cos 3 pi by 5. Again, the same form. Cos 3 pi by 5 is pi minus 2 pi by 5. Simplify. Convert to 18 degrees and 36 degrees. Convert to 18 and 36 degrees. So, automatically, we are getting like this. Cos pi by 5 cos 2 pi by 5. Cos 36 minus cos 72. Cos 72 is sin 18. Simplify, you get ultimately minus 6. So to our surprise, we can easily see that this product in B, the answer B, the product x square minus 2x cos pi by 5 plus 1, x square minus 2x cos 3 pi by 5 plus 1, simplifies to exactly grouping the terms containing x cube, x square, x. Exactly, it simplifies to x power 4 minus x cube plus x square minus x plus 1. What's the conclusion? The conclusion is, this product, by taking pi by 5 as 36 degrees and 2 pi by 5 as 36 degrees, 72 degrees, automatically this product reduces to x power 4 minus x cube plus x square minus x plus 1. Therefore, the conclusion is, first answer is not correct. The second answer, after finding the product, exactly simply applying simple trigonometry, it reduces to x power 4 minus x cube plus x square minus x plus 1. So therefore, B is our correct answer. If you try with C, find a product, apply same product rule, sum rule, everything, that will not reduce to x power 4 minus x cube plus x square minus x. Of course, you may get some terms, this term may coincide, but these two terms may not coincide. All the terms must coincide. Then only we can say this is also correct. So therefore, this is not correct.
and automatically this is correct. So this is also not correct. The correct answer is D. The correct answer is D. It's a very interesting IIT problem. It's not easy to solve this kind of problem because it requires a lot of concepts, a lot of fundamental concepts we require to solve this problem. Okay. This problem, again, very, very important problem. A lot of explanation can be given. And before that, let us analyze the problem. Z is in terms of a complex number. Z is a complex number, I log 2 minus root 3. Z is I log 2 minus root 3. What is cos Z? Answer is I, 2i, 1, 2. Out of 4 answers, we have to pick out one answer. Then Z is I log 2 minus root 3. What is cos Z? That's our problem. Okay. So, first of all, you must know e power I theta is cos theta plus I sin theta. This is Euler's formula. E power I theta is cos theta plus I sin theta. E power minus I theta is cos theta minus I sin theta. But e power I theta is cos theta plus I theta, e power minus I theta is cos theta minus I sin theta. We add these two. Adding cos theta plus cos theta, 2 cos theta, this gets cancelled. You get 2 cos theta is equal to e power I theta, e power minus I theta. E power I theta plus e power minus I theta divided by 2. If you take 2 here, cos theta is e power I theta plus e power minus I theta by 2. Whatever theta may be, theta can be real or complex. When theta is real, you can automatically we can substitute here for theta, we can simplify. What is cos 30 degrees? Cos I 30 degrees, e power minus I 30 degrees, simplify, automatically we will be getting the value of cos 30 degrees. Cos 60 degrees. Even theta can be replaced by a complex number also. If theta is complex, in the given problem, theta can be real or complex. So in the given problem, theta is a complex number. When theta is a complex number, automatically we can substitute that complex number here, here, simplify. That is the value of cos z, when z is a complex number. So for that, what we do is, z is I log 2 minus root 3, cos z we want. Cos z, according to the formula just now I have given, e power I z plus e power minus I z by Euler's rule divided by 2. This is our cos z formula. I am substituting for z this complex number I log I square minus 1. Here minus I square becomes plus 1. So let us simplify as usual. Cos z is e power I z plus e power minus z by 2. This is not z, this is 2, this is 2. I am substituting for z, I log 2 minus root 3, I square minus 1, you get e power minus log 2 minus root 3 plus e power log root 2 minus root 3, because minus I square you get plus here. So e power log 2 minus root 3. We all know minus log a by b, or we can also say minus log a is nothing but log 1 by a. Log 1 over a. So minus log a is log 1 over a. Therefore minus log 2 minus root 3 is written as log 1 over 2 minus root 3. E power log 2 minus root 3. We are having one result in logarithm. One result in logarithm. That says e power logarithm of any function, this can be derived easily, is equal to that function. E power log fx is fx. E power log fx is fx. E power log x, x. E power log x square, x square. E power log 1 by x, 1 by x. E power log sin x,
e power log sin x is sin x. E power log any function is that function. So this is a property of logarithm. I am making use of this property. E power log of 1 over 2 minus root 3 is 1 over 2 minus root 3. E power log 2 minus root 3 is 2 minus root 3. Simplify this, taking LCM 2 minus root 3. Automatically this gives us 2. So therefore the answer is cos z is I 2i 1 2. 2 is the correct answer. When z is a complex number, cos z can be obtained. That gives us exactly 2 in our case. Exactly 2 in our case. Another interesting simple problem. Z power 4 is equal to I. Z power 4 is equal to I. What is Z? Cos pi by 4, cos pi by 8, minus I by 8, I. We are applying De Moivre's theorem. We are applying De Moivre's theorem to solve this problem. Z power 4 is I. First of all, convert I in the modulus amplitude form. We all know I is nothing but cos pi by 2 plus I sine pi by 2. We all know I is cos pi by 2 plus I sine pi by 2. Cos 90 is 0, sine 90 is 1. Therefore, you get simply I. So, I. So 1 is the modulus, pi by 2 is the amplitude. So, for the complex number I, for this complex number I, if you convert to modulus amplitude form, you get 1 time cos pi by 2 plus I sin pi by 2. So 1 is the modulus, pi by 2 is the amplitude. So that will do to solve this problem. Z power 4 is equal to I. Therefore, Z is equal to I power 1 by 4. I power 1 by 4. Raising both sides to the power 1 by 4. Z power 4, power 1 by 4, you get Z power 1. I power 1 by 4, you get. Replacing I in the modulus amplitude form. Replacing I in the modulus amplitude form, cos pi by 2 plus I sin pi by 2, power 1 by 4. Apply De Moivre's theorem, you get cos pi by 4 times 1 by 4. Pi by 4 times 1 by pi by 2 times 1 by 4. You get cos pi by 8 plus I sin pi by 8. Now, we call this cos pi by 8. We write usually cos theta plus I sin theta as sys theta. This is short form of writing cos theta plus I sin theta. Therefore, this is nothing but, this is not cos, this is nothing but sys. Sys pi by 8. So, cos pi by 8 plus I sin pi by 8. We are writing this as sys pi by 8. So, out of the answers, this is sys pi by 8. You replace this answer by sys pi by 8, and if it is sys pi by 8, this is the correct answer. Otherwise, all the answers are wrong. So, this, you replace cos by sys, and the correct answer is sys pi by 8. Okay. We are having another very, very interesting problem. This requires a lot of explanation. An is an nth root of unity. A1, A2, A3, etc. An. An is the nth root of unity. Then, 1 plus 2 times AR, 3 times AR square, etc. N terms is. If you take this series, which is called arithmetico geometric series. I'll give an explanation. You consider a series 1 plus 2 times AR, 3 times AR square, 4 times, we can understand the rhythm 1, 2, 3, 4, etc. They are in arithmetic progression. AR, AR square, AR cubed, etc. They are in geometric progression. It's a combination of arithmetic progression and geometric progression. That's why this is called arithmetico. This is called arithmetico geometric series. This is called arithmetico-geometric series. Because 1, 2, 3, 4, etc. they are in arithmetic progression. AR, AR square, AR cube, they are in geometric progression. Here AR is nothing but 1 nth root of unity. Because nth roots of unity, we know 1 omega, omega square, etc. omega power n minus 1. These are the nth roots of unity. You can call these as AR, or you can call this as A1, you can call this as A2, you can call this as AN minus 1. Like that. Or you can also call this as A1, A2, A3, etc. AN. So this A1, A2, A3, etc. they are nothing but, as R varies, gives nth roots of unity. Assuming AR stands for nth roots of unity. What is 1 plus 2 AR, 3 AR square, 4 AR cube, etc. The series goes. We are taking up to n terms. We are taking up to n terms. The sum is n by 1 minus AR whole square minus n by 1 minus AR minus 2n by 1 minus AR minus 2n by 1 minus AR whole square, which is the correct answer among them. It's a problem under summation of series. We are not discussed summation of series, but anyhow, I'll give the methodology to find a summation of a series. It's a very interesting chapter for competent examination. Summation is very, very important. Let us take. I am calling the sum as S. Understand carefully. 1, 2 times AR. This is our second term. Second term, AR power 1. Third term AR power 2, nth term, third term power 2, nth term power n minus 1, nth term power n. But the second term 2, third term 3, nth term n. So if you take 1, 2, 3, etc., this is n. If you take this power 1, 2, 3, etc., this is n minus 1, because one number is reduced here. So therefore, you can easily understand why that nth term is n times AR power n minus 1. If you understand the logic, 1, 2, 3, etc., nth term we get n. For AR power 1, AR power 2, deleting this term, AR power n, AR power 2, AR power n minus 1, because we are having n minus 1 terms here, deleting 1. So therefore, we can simply say our nth term is n times AR power n minus 1. What we do is, in this series, we are multiplying by AR. This procedure is followed only when you have arithmetico-geometric series, not for any other series. To find the summation of an arithmetico-geometric series, we multiply each and every term by AR. We multiply each and every term by AR. First term, we are multiplying by AR. Second term, we are multiplying by AR. It is 2 times AR, you get 2 AR square. So we have to give a shift. We have to give a shift here. You must write AR here. 2 times AR square here, etc. One term is shifted, therefore n times AR power n here. It's written here. Therefore, I am multiplying each and every term by AR. At the same time, I am giving a shift while writing. Instead of writing AR here, I am writing AR here. Instead of writing 2 AR square here, I am writing 2 AR square here. I am giving a shift. I am giving a shift. Therefore, our last term is written here. You just subtract. I repeat again. We are calling the summation as S. We are calling the summation as S. Multiply each and every term by AR. Give a shift. That is, 1 into AR, I am writing it here. 2 AR into AR, you get 2 AR square, I am writing it here, below AR square. Below AR, like that. You multiply this by AR, you get n AR power n. I am writing it there. You subtract this minus this. S minus AR S. S into 1 minus AR. 1 is retained as H. 2ar minus ar, 3ar square minus ar square, ar square. Like that, you get ar power n minus 1, ar, ar square, etc. 1ar, 1ar square, 1ar power n minus 1. Last term, you get minus n ar power n. Because we are subtracting, this term becomes negative, minus n ar power n. Now, this 1 ar, ar square, ar power n minus 1, carefully you must understand. Because understanding arithmetico-geometric series, because two series are involved, we are coming to a geometric series. 1 ar, ar square, ar power n minus 1. This is nothing but, up to this, from this to this, we are having n terms. Ar power 1, ar power 2, ar power n minus 1. Up to this, n minus 1 term, including this, n terms. You get n terms, sum to n terms of a geometric progression. First term is ar. First term is 1, common ratio is ar. First term is 1, common ratio is ar. Because the ratio, ar square by ar, that is ar, like that. We know sum to n terms is given by the formula a into r power n minus 1 by r minus 1. This is the sum to n terms of a geometric progression. I am using that formula. First term is 1. That is a is 1. Common ratio is ar, ar power n, because there are n terms from this to this. Minus 1 by ar minus 1. And I am retaining last term as such, n ar power n. Now, this ar is nothing but 1 nth root of unity. Ar is nothing but the nth root of unity. Suppose, whenever you have fifth roots of unity, it should satisfy this equation. If omega is fifth root of unity, omega power 5 should be equal to 1. Omega power 5 is equal to 1. If ar is the nth root of unity, therefore, ar power n must be equal to 1. Therefore, ar power n is equal to 1. So, ar power n is equal to 1. Because ar happens to be the nth root of unity. Therefore, this term becomes 0. This term becomes 0. And again, ar power n is 1. Here, 1 minus 1, it becomes 0. Since it is ar power n occurring with the n, we get ar power n into n, you get minus. Therefore, s into 1 minus ar is minus n. Therefore, s is equal to n minus n by 1 minus ar. Hope it is clear. I'll repeat again from the beginning. An or ar, you can take this as ar. Ar is the nth root of unity. Then 1 plus 2 times ar, 3 times ar square, etc. n terms is what? What we do is, you take this series, you call the series as s. S is the sum to infinity of the series. You multiply by ar, you multiply each and every term by ar, and give a shift. Give a shift in the sense, I am writing ar here, I am writing ar square, 2 times ar square here. In the last term, I am writing here. Subtract. Subtracting s into 1 minus ar, 1 remains as it is. 2 ar minus ar, ar. 3 ar square minus 2 ar square, you get 1 ar, 1 ar square, etc. 1 ar minus 1. Last term is minus n ar power n. This becomes sum to n terms of a geometric progression. Apply the formula. Ar power n minus 1 by ar minus 1. Ar power n is nothing but 1, because ar happens to be the nth root of unity. Therefore, ar power n is 1. Therefore, 1 minus 1, 0. This term becomes 0. Once this term becomes 0, is ar power n becomes 1, you are left with minus n. S times 1 minus r is minus n. S is equal to minus n times n by 1 by 1 minus ar. It's a very interesting problem. It's a very, very interesting problem. It comes under arithmetico-geometric series. At the same time, we are combining nth roots of unity also. Nth root of unity also in this problem. Okay. Another very, very important problem. Very, very important problem for all competent examination. It requires a lot of understanding. It requires a lot of understanding. Find the maximum and the minimum values of mod z when mod z minus 2 is equal to 1. Find the maximum and minimum values of mod z when mod z minus 2 is equal to 1. We are finding the maximum value of mod z for all z satisfying this equation. For all z satisfying this equation. Of all z, which z gives a maximum mod z? For which z, mod z will be maximum. Okay. First of all, mod z minus 2 is equal to 1 represents what? Mod z minus 2 is equal to 1 represents a circle center at 2 radius 1 unit. Radius 1 unit. That is, in the organ diagram, 0 is here, 1 is here, 2 is here. Mod z minus 2 is 1 means center 2 radius 1. Radius 1 means automatically you will be getting a circle like this. Center 2, radius 1. Radius 1. This is 3, 0. This is 1, 0. Z, you can take any Z only on the circle, not anywhere. You can take Z only on the circle and not anywhere. Not inside, not outside. We can take Z only. For which Z on the circle, on this circle, for which z on this circle, mod z means the distance is maximum. The distance is maximum. Like for any z, you take a distance from the origin. For which z on the circle, mod z is maximum. Now see, it's a very interesting problem. Center is 2, radius is 1. Therefore, this is 2, 0. This is 1, 0. This is 1, 0. Mod z minus 2 is equal to 1 is this circle. This circle. At P, mod z means the distance. At P, mod z is 1. That is minimum. You take anywhere. You take this z or this z or this mod distance. That will be greater than 1. So therefore, mod z is minimum at z is equal to 1. At z is equal to 1. Among all these distances, among all these distances, this distance is maximum. This distance is maximum. Therefore, this is the farthest point from the origin, not this one. This is the farthest point from the origin. So therefore, automatically, for this point, mod z is nothing but this distance. Mod z is this distance. That is nothing but 3. So, maximum, mod z is minimum at z is equal to 1. Mod z is maximum at z is equal to 3. Therefore, maximum mod z is 3. And the minimum mod z is 1. Any point, you take this point, this point, this point, this point. Take modulus, distance. Maximum mod z will be 3 and minimum mod z will be 1. Any other modulus you take for a complex number lying on the circle, mod z minus 2 is equal to 1, that modulus will be less than 3. You can easily verify. So therefore, maximum mod z is 3 and minimum mod z is 1 for this problem. Many problems can be coined based on this. Z by 1 plus z is purely imaginary. Then show that z is neither real nor purely imaginary. Under this condition, z by 1 plus z is purely imaginary. That means real part is 0. You simplify this complex number by varying z,
Take z as a general complex number x plus iy. Show that z is neither purely real nor purely imaginary. Let us simplify this. Z by 1 plus z. X plus iy by 1 plus x plus iy. Z is x plus iy. The conjugate of the denominator is 1 plus x minus iy. Multiply and divide by the conjugate of the denominator. Therefore, we make a real denominator a real number. Simplify this. Simplify this. We get 0. So, by giving 0, by getting 0, we can simply come to a conclusion. Z is neither real nor purely imaginary. Since we are getting 0, we come to a conclusion. Z is neither real nor purely imaginary. Now, here, we are taking some problems. Omega is a cube root of unity. Omega is a cube root of then A is a matrix consisting of omega 0 0 omega. A is a matrix omega 0 0 omega. It's a diagonal matrix and omega stands for a cube root of unity. Our question is, what is a power 100? A power 100, the four answers are, it is minus a, it is null, it is a transpose. Four answers are here. Omega is the cube root of unity. Matrix A consists of omega as a diagonal element. Omega, two diagonal elements, omega, omega. Omega is nothing but a cube root of unity. Omega cubed is equal to 1. That's the meaning of that. What is a power 100? Is it possible for us to find a power 100? Yes. A is omega 0, 0, omega. What is a square? Omega 0, 0, omega. Omega 0, 0 omega. We are multiplying A with A. So, this gives omega square 0, 0 omega square. What will be A cube? A cubed will be omega cube 0, 0 omega cube. What will be A power 100 by rhythm? For a square, we get omega square, omega square. For a cubed, we get omega cubed, omega cubed. Diagonal elements. For a power 100, you get omega power 100. You get omega power 100, omega power 100. What is omega power 100? If omega is imaginary cube root of unity, omega cubed is 1. And omega power 100, omega power 99 into omega. This is 1. Because omega power 33 power 3 or omega power 3 power 33. So this is 1. Omega power 99 is 1. We are left with omega. Therefore, this reduces to omega 0, 0, omega, which is nothing but A itself. Therefore, A power 100 is A. So omega happens to be imaginary cube root of unity. So because omega cubed is equal to 1, omega power 99 is 1, omega power 100 is omega power 99 into omega, the omega power 100 is omega, therefore omega 0, 0, omega, which is nothing but the given matrix itself. Therefore, A power 100 is A itself. The omega happens to be the imaginary cube root of unity. It's a very simple, interesting problem based on cube root of unity. Let us take another problem. Very important problem. Mod z1 plus z2.
is equal to mod z1 plus mod z2.
Z1 and z2 are two complex numbers satisfying mod z1 plus z2 is mod z1 plus mod z2. Then, which of the following, is bar R2?
That is, sometimes one correct answer will be there or two correct answers will be there. That's why which of the following is true or true. If there are more than one correct answer, are true. Only one correct answer is true. The answers are, the argument of z1 minus argument of z2 is equal to 0. The second answer is, argument of z1 minus argument of z2 is equal to 5 by 2. Third answer, z1 by z2 is real. Fourth answer, mod z1 minus z2, is equal to modulus mod z1 minus mod z2. I'll repeat again. Z1 and Z2 are two complex numbers satisfying mod Z1 plus Z2 is equal to mod Z plus mod Z2. This is a given condition. Then which of the following is bar R true? Argument of Z1 minus argument of Z2 is 0. Argument of Z1 minus argument of Z2 is pi by 2. Z1 by Z2 is real. Modulus of Z1 minus Z2 is modulus of Z1 minus modulus of Z2. Modulus of Z1 minus modulus of Z2. Which is correct? Which are correct? Now here, it's a very interesting problem for discussion. Whenever mod Z1 plus Z2 is equal to mod Z1 plus mod Z2, we are having a major inference. We are having a major inference. That inference is, whenever this condition mod Z1 plus Z2 is equal to mod Z1 plus mod Z2, then Z1 and Z2 are collinear in the organ diagram. Z1 and Z2 are collinear with the origin. Z1 and Z2 are collinear with the origin. When mod Z1 plus Z2 is equal to mod Z1 plus mod Z2. That is the inference. Under this condition, it may be purely real or purely imaginary or general complex numbers. Even if you take two complex numbers here, if they are collinear with the origin, mod Z1 plus Z2 is mod Z1 plus mod Z2. Even if you take two complex numbers, I and 2i, I and 2i, they are all collinear with the origin. We can take complex numbers in the organ diagram, they are collinear with the origin. This condition is satisfied. Very, very important condition for facing complex examination. For example, we can take Z1 as 1 plus i. We can take Z1 as 1 plus i. Z2 as 2 plus 2i. Then Z1 plus Z2 will be 3 plus 3i. 3 plus 3i. They are all complex numbers. 1 plus i, 2 plus 2i, 3 plus 3i, they are all complex numbers lying in the same line through the origin. 1 plus i is here, 2 plus 2i is here, 3 plus 3i is also here, z1 plus z2 is also here. Mod z1 will be root 2, mod z2 will be 2 root 2, mod z1 plus z2 will be 3 root 2. we get mod z1 plus mod z2 is mod z1 plus z2. Mod z1 plus z2. So therefore, the inference is whenever mod z1 plus z2 is mod z1 plus mod z2, the two complex numbers are collinear with the origin. Even if you take I to I, mod z1 is modulus I is 1, mod 2 I is 2, I plus 2 I 3, mod z1 plus z2 is 3. Anywhere you can take complex numbers, if they are collinear with the origin, this condition is satisfied. Accordingly, the argument of z1 is same as argument of z2. Argument of z1 is same as argument of z2. Therefore, the inference is argument of z1 minus argument of z2, they are all equal. The first inference is argument of z1 minus argument of z2 is 0 is correct. So therefore, we infer that argument of z1 minus argument of z2 is equal to 0. This is a true statement. First statement is a true statement. Whereas, another statement is argument of z1 minus argument of z2 is equal to pi by 2 is a false statement. It's not correct. This is a correct statement. So out of four statements, we have verified the validity of the first two statements. First statement is true, second statement is false. Pi by 4 or pi by 2, whatever it may be. Even if it is pi by 4, it is wrong. Pi by 2 is wrong. Whereas, in the organ diagram, z1 is here, z2 is here, 1 plus I have taken, 2 plus 2i I have taken here, 3 plus 3i I have taken here. It's here, like that. What happens to z1 by z2? Z1 is 1 plus I, z2 is 2 times 1 plus I. We get 1 by 2, which is real. Whether even in this case, if you take I to I, I by 2 I, 1 by 2. You can take complex numbers here on this line, even then. So in all the cases, in general, when mod z1 plus z2 is mod z1 plus mod z2, necessarily z1 by z2 is real. Z1 by z2 is real. You can ask, z2 by z1? Even if you take z2 by z1, even if you take z2 by z1, that is also real. That is, z1 by z2 is real. Z2 by Z1 is also real. Either this way or that way, in both ways, one complex number, the quotient of two complex numbers, Z1 and Z2, is always real. If you take Z1 numerator or Z2 numerator. Third case, we are verifying modulus of Z1 minus Z2. You take z1 minus z2 or z2 minus z1? Z1 minus z2 will be minus 1 minus I. Modulus of minus 1 minus I. That is root 2. That is root 2. You find a mod z1 minus mod z2. Modulus of that. You find a modulus of mod z1 minus mod z2. Again you get root 2. Again you get a root 2. Therefore, we are getting the inference that argument of z1 minus argument of z2 is equal to 0 is a true statement. Argument of z1 minus argument of z2 is equal to 5 by 2 is a false statement. Z1 by Z2 or Z2 by Z1 is real. It's a true statement. Modulus of Z1 minus Z2 is equal to modulus of mod Z1 minus mod Z2 is a true statement. So out of 4, 3 are correct. They will give the answers. A and B are correct. A, C, D are correct. A, B, C, D are correct. So here A, C, D are correct. So out of 3 answers, A is correct, C is correct, D is correct. A, C, D are true. And only D is false. Sometimes they will give one answer, B, C, D, A, B, C, something like that. So therefore, you must pick out the right answer and say, this is A is correct, C is correct, D is correct. 3 right answers are there. So therefore, A, C, D are correct. So this type of problem is very important for facing complex examination. Next class, we are solving some more problems under complex number, and after that we are passing on to next chapter.